I've never seen like AGI being more plausible than we are standing right now. So my hot take, where we are right now, 2024, 5 years out, I would see us be able to get to very, very intelligent machines.
Hello and happy Friday. You're listening to Mixture of Experts. I'm your host, Tim Hwang, back again. Each week, Mixture of Experts distills down the week's most important headlines and chatter in the world of artificial intelligence. From research papers and product announcements to ethics, governance, and just plain gossip, we've got you covered. This week on the show, first, the annual ACM Conference on Fairness, Accountability, and Transparency, or FAccT, is happening this week in Rio. We'll talk about the latest developments in ML fairness and the state of responsible AI. Next up, Leopold Aschenbrenner's AI safety screed Situational Awareness hit the airwaves with a widely talked about interview with Dwarkesh Patel. What's the best way to forecast AI capabilities and what's going on with safety at OpenAI? And finally, benchmarking, benchmarking, benchmarking. This week, we talk about the latest in RAG benchmarking and what it tells us about the industry as a whole. As always, I'm joined by an incredible group of experts who will help us cut through the noise and drop some hot takes as we go. Vagner Santana, staff research scientist, master inventor, and importantly, debuting for the first time on MOE. Vagner, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Next up, Marina Danilesky, senior research scientist. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks. Happy to be here.
And Shobhit Varshney, who has been with us since episode number one, senior partner consulting on AI for US, Canada, and Latin America. Shobhit, welcome back to the show.
Absolutely love these. Thanks for having me again.
All right, well, let's just jump right into it. So the first story I want to cover is the annual FAccT Conference is happening this year in Rio. For those who don't know, it is arguably the leading conference on topics of machine learning fairness and responsible AI. And I thought this would be a good jumping off point just because if you've been watching the space for some time, responsible AI and ML fairness has become kind of a buzzword that lots and lots of people have used in recent years. And I think these conferences are a good time to check in on what the kind of state of play is in fairness and accountability questions in AI. And Vagner, one of the reasons I wanted to have you on the show was you've been watching kind of the papers and the chatter around the conference. Maybe I can just kind of toss it to you first for our listeners. Any sort of patterns or trends that you've noticed, I think, this year, FAccT, if there's particular papers that you think people should check out, just curious about your review or your kind of thoughts on what you're seeing out there at this year's conference.
Sure. There are interesting discussions around synthetic data, around how people are using LLMs to create data and then also to assess LLMs using LLMs. So there's this discussion going on. Also about responsible AI, one of the papers I selected to discuss with y'all, I think has to do with how people are learning about responsible AI on the job. I think that that's important because people are getting interested and people are following and trying to find resources, but then that comes with all the complexities of working in an organization. So that is one aspect as well. And well, the other aspect connects with copyright and also how to deal with all the labor that is being packed by the use of LLMs in a wide range of jobs around the world.
Yeah, for sure. And I did want to pick up on that second theme specifically. You know, there's much more, as true with all these conferences, there's many more papers than you'd ever have time to discuss. But I think what's so interesting about the responsible AI topic is, you know, this is really an evolution, I think, in fairness in ML, where I would say even a few years ago, basically a lot of the attention was like, can we define in computational terms what a fair machine learning algorithm is? And it kind of feels like there's a lot more work now that's happening in this much broader question, which is, okay, well, we have all these techniques and approaches around fairness in ML. How do we actually get like an organization to implement it? How do we get people to learn about it? What are the techniques that people use? And, you know, Vagner, I think in addition to your research, it kind of sounds like you've been doing some work on this internally within IBM. And so kind of just curious if you want to talk a little bit about that paper that you mentioned and then just kind of map it to your own experience. I think I'm curious about like what you're sort of learning as someone who's, you know, very much in the trenches, you know, trying to get this work to work.
Sure. Yeah. And one of the aspects that the paper covers and has to do with incentives. And we need to be aware of the incentives that our organizations have before thinking about responsible AI, because otherwise, we'll be facing a lot of blockers along the way. And also, there's an interesting aspect that the paper highlights about the discipline identities that we have. When we are like in hard technical teams, they have their own discipline identities. And when they are looking for, let's say, resources about responsible AI, they'll probably go into resources they are used to look for. So they're going to be looking for technical libraries or metrics. And sometimes we need to go beyond this, our own discipline identity, and look for other skills and other disciplines, and to learn more about, let's say, socio-technical impacts, right? And beyond focusing on, let's say, some fairness metrics for folks focusing on more technical aspects. And the other way as well, right? For people thinking about, let's say, indirect impacts on society, they also need to be aware of the daily job of data scientists and coders and researchers. And how can we like do this connection, right?
Yeah, I think your just rundown, I think, runs into, or I think highlights, I think, a bunch of the issues. You know, I think it was a joke that I had with a friend for a while that like, oh, the main thing a lot of big companies would do when they wanted to do like ethical AI or responsible AI would be like, well, we're going to create like this like secret group of lawyers that will just determine everything. And it was like, this is like not a good way of doing, you know, things. And I guess I'm kind of curious. I mean, Marina, if I can bring you into this discussion, you know, I guess maybe one thing I'd be curious about is like how you all think about things like fairness and responsible AI in RAG, right? Which are you're literally trying to pull information from another source. And I guess I'm kind of curious about like if you've kind of, you know, have thoughts on this particular discussion, right? Like how should organizations kind of best organize themselves to do this right? Because I think part of it is this kind of interdisciplinary crosstalk, which I think organizations of different size, you know, do better or worse at, you know, in different capacities.
I think something that Vagner said about incentives really pops up here as well, which is why should you care? Well, it's because you would like your customers finally to be using your RAG system. And if it is giving answers that are not not even so much fair, but there's a risk that it's going to give something that is irresponsible, that is going to lead to your users being misled or being upset or taking legal action, then your solution is not going to be bought. It's not going to be taken. So actually, because we usually are looking at enterprise use cases, we are very, very incentivized to make sure that we are communicating things that are, you know, fair, ethical, regardless of what our own ideas are. It's because if we don't succeed in that, it will not be purchased. The risk is too high. There's too many, you know, fun stories in the news about what happens when you don't pay enough attention to that.
Yeah. So you're actually seeing that, because I think, I don't know, I had a fear, you know, which I still kind of have, which is like maybe this discussion is going to become a little bit like data privacy, where like I think early on there was kind of this idea that like, oh, well, the minute there's a really big data breach, then everybody's suddenly going to care about data privacy and security. And like consumers will all prefer the better privacy option, right? But then I think you could make the argument that one of the things that's happened is that there's just like so many huge data breaches now, so many big failures that almost like the Overton window has shifted. We're just kind of like, oh, you know, someone leaked billions of customer records. I guess that just happens. But that is something that you're seeing. It kind of sounds like that, like at least in fairness, because we've had all these high profile failures, it's not necessarily people have just become resigned to it. Actually, it still remains kind of like a thing that people are really concerned about.
Yeah, we're seeing this quite a bit, right? If you look at the AI culture, the AI framework, responsible AI framework, on what would you prioritize and which ones are high risk, how do you categorize use cases, so on and so forth. And there's actual tooling and platforms that are needed to go drive these at enterprises, right? And those three layers have to be addressed one by one. The AI culture around, hey, look at your day-to-day workflows and see where you can apply AI, and you have to do this in a responsible way, and here's a framework around it. Unfortunately, the reality on the ground for most of the Fortune 100 companies that I work with, the responsible AI team, you have to go, it's easy to go create a governance board, and you go to the governance board for guidance and coaching and making sure that you're not doing the wrong things. Unfortunately, it becomes, I'm going to quote Lord of the Rings, Gandalf standing on a bridge and saying, you shall not pass, right? Go back to the shadow. So we've somehow created a forcing function that anything that goes to the governance board adds about 2 months of delay to a project. So the value, the unlock for the business gets diminished. It's like, hey, I might as well not even deal with this and I should just go stick to my RPAs or automation scripts or regular AI stuff, and that'll be just fine, right? So they've become a rate limiting step at this point, and that has to fundamentally change. And for that, the next layer that I was talking about in terms of platforms, that becomes more and more critical. So instead of saying that, hey, you need to go figure out all these 20 different checklists in your RAG pattern so I can know exactly where the data is coming from, there's metrics that I need to report against, and so on and so forth, now you start to move towards a platform approach where you say, use the platform pre-approved accelerators. All the RAG, when we looked at RAG patterns within IBM Consulting, within a week's time, we had like 121 different ways in which people were doing RAGs. And we said, guys, time out. We got to go consolidate. We'll create scribe flow. We'll create a mechanism that has the best of all techniques in one single spot, right? So when you start to get to a platform, then you come to a point where the governance boards are pointing you towards accelerators versus becoming a you shall not pass moment. Right, I think that the whole culture leading to governance, then leading to the stack. And we're doing this with a lot of our Fortune 100 companies. Recently, a couple of weeks back, I had Pepsi on stage with us, where we're talking about how we're helping them build a culture of responsible AI and the frameworks and so on and so forth. Mm. This is one of the many examples where we've had to go do this end to end, from culture to frameworks to actual tooling that goes and deploys that.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And actually, I should add that I'm surprised that it has taken this long for us to get to a Lord of the Rings reference. So I think we're at episode 6 right now. This is the first one that we've actually heard. Yeah, exactly. Well, and I think, I don't know, I mean, maybe one last nuance to kind of touch on, I'd be curious to get the panel's thoughts, and Vagner, maybe to throw it back to you, is like, you know, so for the last few episodes, we've all been very excited about open source. And it feels like part of the problem of open source is that, you know, suddenly, like, your fairness methodologies are almost competing with, like, just being able to, like, pull something off the shelf and, like, deploy it in any reckless way that you really want to. And I guess I'm kind of curious about, like, how we think about sort of responsible AI going forwards in a world where, like, anyone can just pull AI off the shelf and use it. Because it feels like in a world where, like, maybe there's only two or three platforms, you really can say, okay, well, if you want access to this advanced technology, you're going to have to go through this additional compliance cost, even if it takes you a little bit more time. But that kind of lever is, I don't know, from my point of view, seems to be like breaking down a little bit as it becomes more and more accessible. I don't know if you buy that. You might also just say, Tim, you're totally wrong. But I don't know, Vagner, if you've got any thoughts on that, or anyone really.
Yeah, in terms of open source, I think that the interesting aspect is that people have more transparency, as we all know, and also thinking about fully open source models, because people are also discussing that when you also only have the model and you don't know the data used to train the model, you just have open source model. And when you know more about the model, then you have a fully open source, right? So I think that that's important. And people are getting more and more interested on that. And when we talk to clients, they are also interested on finding the right model for the right task. I think that that is also interesting, pattern that is emerging. Like, people discussing, okay, is this the right size of model for solving my problem? Is this language model or generative AI fully open? Can I host that in my own private cloud? So these are questions that are appearing when we talk about responsible AI right now.
Yeah, I'm coming in from a very enterprise approach to this, because like my square focus is how do we scale these, right? And when you look at a step-by-step process, any workflow that's happening in an organization today, right? 7 different steps. Step number one, you're going to pull some data. Step number three, you're going to do some fraud detection. Step number four, now you're going to go extract something from a document, an invoice, a contract, something that came to you, right? Now, say where I was able to do OCR and pull that out with about 80% accuracy so far, right? That's best where we were. Now, all of a sudden, we have LLMs, and we say, hey, I have reason to believe that I could potentially get about 92% accuracy. I can squeeze more out of this document, right? So now we're seeing about 10, 12 points of additional benefit that you can derive from it, right? At that point, we stop and say, if you have reason to believe an LLM could do this, let's talk about constraints. The constraints are on cost envelope, right? How much can I afford? If I'm doing this 1,000 times or 1,000,000 times, there's a different ROI attached to it, right? Then there is security of where the data resides. Models follow the data gravity. They go, we deploy them closer to where the restricted data sets are, and so on and so forth. Then you start to look at how quickly you need an answer. The latency of a model matters. You're trying to start figuring out, from a compliance perspective, will I have to go explain to somebody how I came up with this answer, which means I need auditable responses, I need more deterministic responses in certain use cases, and so on and so forth. So you come up with a set of constraints, and given those 5-10 different constraints, now you have 2 or 3 good athletes that you start to test with. And then from there on, we start to move towards metrics and see which one is giving me more versus the others, and so on and so forth. But it's very critical at a step level, at a sub task level, you're trying to figure out which LLM is going to do the job. And we're getting away from, earlier we said, can a GPT-4 model do the entire workflow end-to-end? So we'll talk about that in a little bit, but I think we're still at the sub-task level. We're surgically infusing AI and Gen AI and seeing if it can do this one thing incredibly well. I'll take care of the rest before and after.
Yeah, no, I think it makes a lot of sense. And I think goes to this really interesting question, which we won't have time to address today, but we should do on a future episode is, you know, what's that mean for responsible AI, right? Because it's like, you know, you have lots and lots of submodules that may have, you know, various different types of problems. There's almost kind of a question about whether or not any one deployment is responsible, but then whether or not the whole system hangs together is a whole nother set of analysis, right? That actually is another question. Great. So I want to move us to the second topic of today. This is a really big week if you track the discourse around artificial general intelligence. Leopold Aschenbrenner, who is a former OpenAI Super Alignment team member, published this massive online screed called Situational Awareness. This would have kind of existed, I think, as sort of a weird, obscure screed. But Leopold ended up doing an interview with Dwarkesh Patel, the sort of influential tech podcaster. And this story and this document has now just gone everywhere. So I've caught up with friends who, you know, work in policy in DC saying, we're getting calls from congressional offices saying what our take is on situational awareness. So I just want to take a quick breather here because the claims of situational awareness are quite breathless. The argument is if you take all the existing trends in AI and you project linearly, we will reach a point where AI becomes, you know, sort of transformational in its impact. And so I think this is kind of a great opportunity to bring in you, Shobhit, to this conversation. Because the way I sort of see the discourse is that there's a circle of people who are in like AGI superintelligence land, right? Who are like, the AI is going to take over the world, right? But then I think like there's this vast group of other people who are just like doing work with the technology, who are like talking to companies that are implementing the technology. And I'm kind of curious as someone who's like really right, you know, at the front lines of that, like are companies like situational awareness, do we need to be worried about AGI? Like, does that even enter into the commercial discussion? Or is this like a completely, like almost in the parallel dimension?
I've never seen like AGI being more plausible than we are standing right now. So my hot take, where we are right now, 2024, 5 years out, I would see us be able to get to very, very intelligent machines. Now, the definition of AGI has been very vague, right? Everybody has their own interpretation of what artificial general intelligence would mean. And even if you compare two different people, it's very difficult for us to really have a good metric on, is this person, is Shobhit really intelligent or not, right? Like if you ask my wife or my kids, you'd have a very different answer. So it's we're at a very different point and even being able to define what AGI looks like, right? But if you just talk about intelligence, we've been doing an incredibly good job at making progress every 2 years. If you, like, stepping away from the half a year increments, is looking at a 2 year horizon, right? When GPT-4 stopped training, and you know, they've discussed this in 2022, you're looking at about $500 million spend, about a 10 megawatt, about 25,800 GPUs from NVIDIA at that point, right? That's kind of what they must have spent doing this. 2024, today, you can have 100,000 H100 equivalents. You're seeing how much investment Meta and others are making into this, right? And then you had this huge big announcement with OpenAI and Microsoft that they're going to establish a $100 billion supercomputer, right? Now we're talking about something that starts to get into 2026 timeframe when you can potentially have a gigawatt cluster. You can have this big, big, giant machine, and the power needed for it would be equivalent to, say, the Hoover Dam, right? So or a nuclear reactor, right? So now you're trying to start to say that I can solve a lot of tough problems by throwing more compute at it. That's just part of the equation, right? There's better algorithms, there are better data that's needed. It's a combination of those. You can't overcorrect for bad quality data with having more compute. So we're getting to a point where now you would get to more and more compute power being available. If you keep extrapolating that out, I see a situation where we would have more than a nuclear reactor attached to this one of these big machines, and you can then have a huge cluster that is intelligently look crunching through numbers. I think what he's extrapolating was by 2030, we'll be at 100 gigawatts. I think that's a stretch. That's about 20% of US electric production. But it does bring in a few different aspects of the safety of the AI, who should have access to it, nations versus private sector. We solved for that with the nuclear energy, saying that, hey, only the big national governments should have access to nuclear power, right? To nuclear arsenal. And then we trust that there's a mechanism in place that has checks and balances in the government that has access to something that's super foundational, such a massive impact on humanity. It should be in the hands of governments. But then you start to look at some of the world leaders around right now. A lot of them, and potential elections coming up and stuff too, they don't quite understand what we're dealing with. I'm just looking at the access of AI. I could easily see a geopolitical issue here where the country that has those clusters, if you think about the Oppenheim, if you go back in time and look at what we did during that stage, you would not want to have that entire establishment in a different country, right? US went out of our way to ensure that that's being built inside the United States, right? So you'll see a lot more of concentration of AI superpowers and how much they're investing in building the energy, the requirements, building these massive clusters. And if you follow the trajectory of electric production, I was giving a talk recently on how much was the impact on sustainability perspective of AGI and supercomputers and stuff. And I had looked up this detail around the per capita electric generation, right? How much electricity does each of the countries generate? And if you just look back at the last 30 years, United States has declined 5% in electricity production per capita. United Kingdoms, the UK, has gone down 23% in the last 30 years. China has gone up 9 times in energy production per capita, right? So you're starting to see axes of power, that who has access to what kind of energy, who has access to what kind of compute power. And then to your earlier point, Vagner, once you start to open up these models and open weights being available, you're essentially giving people the recipes of how you can go replicate these things on your own, right? So I think we're at this weird intersection of private versus government. And then does the AI intelligence then dictate geopolitical power? And when does that tip over? At what point does the government start getting really, really serious about safety? Who has access to these technologies inside of OpenAI or the big tech giants and things of that nature? How open are you about what data is going in and so on and so forth? I'm just very fascinated by the impact it's going to have.
Yeah, it's actually, I don't know. I feel like you surprised me there, actually, right? I thought you were going to go in a completely different direction. I feel like when I talk to many kind of folks who are like in enterprise on the business side of this, they'll basically say, this is not happening. This is not realistic. Like, you see what's happening with AI right now. It's never going to be like what this guy Leopold says. And it feels like you're actually going the opposite direction. You kind of say, look, you take all the existing trends, you extrapolate them out, and we're going to be in a really weird place in 24 months. I guess, Marina, Vagner, I'm curious if you two sort of like agree with this kind of assessment, or, you know, from the researcher side, is it right to say, hey, these linear trends are basically what we should use to think about capabilities in, say, 2026?
Tim, we all know that nothing wrong has ever happened from linear extrapolation in the history of humans.
It's very dependable.
Very dependable. This is always how things go. I think I do have a bit of a different perspective than Shobhit, maybe a little bit more like the one that you had said, where, yeah, I don't agree with all of the linear extrapolations. And of course, we all can have the perspectives that we have on how things are going to go. But I think that even if you continue to throw more compute, more data, the way that AI is currently implemented, and we're just in another wave, we've gone through waves before, we're in the current wave, there are, to my mind, limitations to what you're going to be able to achieve. And it is not completely clear how you will actually get out of an AI never recommending you to put glue on pizza just because you gave it more compute and more data. And so I think that while we are closer, we're still not there. And in my mind, there's at least another one or several technological waves that need to come before we really get there. So is there going to be a lot of interesting things coming? Sure. The points that Shobhit raises about accessibility and who gets to actually have these models. That has a lot of really interesting implications for being able to disseminate misinformation, have an impact on how people perceive information, and so on and so forth. Do I think that that's going to get to AGI? Personally, no. But it doesn't mean that it's not going to get to places that are very impactful.
Yeah, and I think there's actually one thread, and maybe I'll throw it to Vagner. I'm curious about your thoughts that I hadn't really thought about, which is very, very interesting, is kind of, I guess there's this kind of bet about, like, what does compute actually get you, right? There's kind of one view, which is if so long as I feed in more data and more compute, the representation in the model will eventually just become accurate. Like, we'll solve the just eat rocks problem by basically, like, you know, kind of like computing our way out of the problem. I guess, Marina, you're kind of saying, I don't want to mischaracterize you, that sort of like, there's actually some genuine questions as to whether or not that will even happen, right? Like, the models will become more powerful, but they might not necessarily become more accurate, right? We normally think about things getting better as, you know, kind of trending in a certain direction. I guess you're saying we can see improvement, but it might be very multidimensional in a way that kind of is a little bit counterintuitive, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that the issue with increasing more or requiring more compute to improve or increase the already really large models, we'll be seeing like less and less organizations controlling everything. So that's, in terms of responsible AI, I think it's something that may be concerning. And in terms of environmental impacts, also people are thinking a lot about the energy that these models are not only requiring for training, but also inference at scale, right? So then I think that balancing all of these, I think that that's a big challenge. And in terms of responsibility, right, what we are always trying to think about is, do we really need to create this technology right now? What are the problems that we're going to solve? Can we solve the problems that we have with the technology we already have, right? There's a lot of interesting questions. And well, in terms of responsible AI, we need to think about these all the time, not only as afterthought, right?
And like part of the responsibility might just be like, no AI.
I think the cost and impact of this is going to start plummeting, right? If you just look at the compute power that's in your phone today, that cost is plummeting. So over time, we'll solve for this. I think from enterprise perspective, Tim, your original question, I think we are overcomplicating how work gets done in an organization. If you have access to hundreds or millions of MIT and Harvard and Stanford grads, and you put them into something very mundane and say, you're going to do procurement analysis, you're going to get an invoice, you're going to compare it against something, right? That's the kind of work that happens in an enterprise, right? So I have reason to believe that if you put a really intelligent person or an equivalent of a person, digital labor, inside of a particular workflow, that sub-task will get done very, very well. There are all kinds of guardrails and stuff that you can create around that particular task. So if you look at it in levels, the first level is, can I do a subtask really well? In the previous discussion, I said step number four, I'm going to extract something out. Can I do that task really well? And that starts to become a specific unit of work. Then you go one level up and say, today a human asks each machine, each LLM to go do different steps. Can I replace that with an orchestration where an LLM agent can figure out a plan, manage the memory and stuff, and automate the entire flow end to end? There's a very plausible path for us to get to figuring out how a step is done, auto orchestrating all of those workflows. And now you start to move up the hierarchy of what a human supervisor would have done versus a summer intern would have told. Right? You'll always double check what a summer intern does. That's where we are today. And over time, you see a progression towards work itself getting automated to with a very, very high accuracy, especially with the costs of AI just plummeting over time.
Yeah, that's almost a great way of thinking about it, is to show by your earlier point about sort of AGI having like this very amorphous definition. It's almost interesting thinking about the idea, like William Gibson has this quote, right? Like, the future is here, it's just not widely distributed yet.
Love this.
Yes. But kind of what you're saying is like, AGI is here, it's just not widely distributed yet. Like, for certain types of tasks, like the AI that we have right now can do all the possible job tasks, right? Yeah. And you're basically just kind of talking about like how far up the organizational chain this thing will go.
So I don't think we'll get into a point where we'll have a crisp definition of what AGI is, and we'll say, hey, today, rah-rah, open a champagne, we'll reach that, right? It's incremental progress. And it's a different definition in each field, in each domain, in each task, right? So I think the right frame is to say that machines will get super intelligent over time, and they will exceed human intelligence in certain tasks. And one thing that humans don't do really well is share our knowledge amongst ourselves, right? If you put two experts in a room, home, it's very difficult for them to actually go at a problem together, right? We don't do a really good job at expanding out using the network effect. I think that's going to change when you have super intelligent machines that can talk to each other and drive better safety, better algorithms, better research, and start to build better algorithms altogether, yep. Right? So I think I'm very excited about the direction that we're going.
So I want to move us on to the final topic. The way I want to tee this up is that there's this famous clip of Steve Ballmer when he was CEO of Microsoft, where he's like, if you've seen Steve Ballmer before, he's like this big muscular guy. He's like very sweaty on stage and he's just shouting, developers, developers, developers. And I kind of feel like if you had played that scene again today, people would be being like, benchmarking, benchmarking, benchmarking. Because I think it is becoming such an important aspect of sort of like the supply chain of AI. There's lots and lots of things we could talk about with benchmarking. We have, and we will continue to. But I think, Marina, particularly with you on the line, I figured it would be great to kind of zoom in specifically to RAG. And do a little bit where we kind of talk to the listeners about essentially what's happening in RAG benchmarking. And then I think from there, kind of talk a little bit about what that tells us about how benchmarking in the industry is evolving, not just in the industry, but I would say in research as well, as a whole. But if you will, I wanted to kind of throw it to you and to say, if it's possible, we'd love kind of a short crash course into how people think about measuring the quality of RAG. And I think that will almost give us something very concrete to talk about in terms of benchmarking generally.
Sure, sounds good. So I will say benchmarking, that's been around for a very long time. It's always been something that was extremely important for systems, databases, ML, everything. So I understand folks are maybe looking at that right now, but
yeah, that's you're kind of saying you're into it test. Before it was cool.
That's right. We were into it before it was cool. We discovered the band first. So the thing right now with RAG, let's talk about what RAG is again real quickly, and then we'll see what it is that you need to evaluate. The retrieval, the augmented, the generation part. All right. So what are you trying to do? You're trying to finally give information that is supported by knowledge that you can say, okay, this is knowledge that I can assume. Here's information I'm giving you. So what happens with RAG? Remember, user has some sort of an inquiry. You fetch something that is related and you say, I'm going to use this information to give you the answer. Okay. Where is all of this going to break? It's going to break when the query is not well formed. So you're not fetching the right thing. If you're not fetching the right thing, then you don't know that there's information you didn't get at. So that's something to evaluate. If you are fetching the right thing or even not the right thing, you then have to generate an answer based on that. Multiple ways that that's going to break down. So you're going to have a model that gives you an answer that's not based on the information you fetched. It's going to give you an incomplete answer. It's going to give you an answer that's a mix of some of it is drawing from it, some of it is drawing from its parameters, some of it is just making up because it decided to go off, especially a little later in the response. And you have to check all of that. Can you force the model to give you a different answer because you told it, no, you told me it was this way, but I'm going to say, now assume it's that way. Okay, can you mess it up that way? Can you give the answer quickly enough? So these are all of the things that you have to manage to evaluate. So when people talk about context relevance or answerability or the faithfulness or completeness, all of these different metrics that people have, this is really what we're talking about when evaluating RAG. A couple of points here. You can try to benchmark against a gold answer, which is usually something that works in cases like classification or anything where there is a very, very clear thing as an answer. The problem with generative AI is, remember that word generative? Everything is created fresh, which means that there might have been a lot of different ways to create an answer. So when you're saying that I'm going to have some sort of an overlap metric like rouge or blue, anything of that kind, that's not always going to be great. It'll tell you if you've gone off completely, but it won't tell you subtleties that, oh, maybe you rephrase the answer a little differently, but it still would have been acceptable. So problems there. So then you say, okay, let's not have references. Let's just judge the answer as it is. The problem with all of the metrics that I just mentioned, nothing has a completely clear definition and it can't. Because you cannot get everybody to agree on what does complete mean, what does faithful mean. Believe me, right. I've tried. We have had so many arguments with research.
Well, I mean, people it's kind of existential because like, yeah, sorry, go ahead.
No, it is. You're completely right. It is like, what does it mean for you that an answer is complete? Not only can the researchers not agree, then the customers can't agree. So when you are talking about benchmarking, there are bits that you try to benchmark first, parts of this system. As Shobhit was saying, well, how do you do on just the retriever part? How do you do on just the generative part? How do you do on, you know, just faithfulness? And the problem is that here, the whole is not the sum of its parts. You put all of that together in an end-to-end experience, and it is not equivalent to, I checked every part individually, therefore I know how it's going to go together. Doesn't go that way. And it's a very difficult thing to actually benchmark, because the more parts there are to a system, the more complex it is to know what happens when you put all of them together in different ways. So that's actually why people are so interested in the benchmarks right now, is because the state of it is a little confusing. It's a little bit incomplete, where just like, what is it that we can actually trust? And then, of course, what we talked about in previous episodes, that the benchmarks do get saturated very quickly. As soon as you have one out, a few months later, okay, everybody already can deal with that one. You know, you got to thank it for its service and move on.
Yeah. What I love about this is that it's like, it starts very tactical and then becomes like existential very quickly, where you're basically like, what is truth? What is clarity anyways?
You know, yes.
Of which like there kind of is no answer. I guess so. I don't know if, Marina, this is a good way to sum it up. I mean, are you sort of saying that there is no RAG benchmark in a certain sense, right? Like that there's no commonly understood norm for judging RAG quality?
We do our best. And I think there are incremental implementations that are better and better and better as we have one benchmark, realize something it didn't cover, do another one, do another one, do another one. So there are, you know, incremental approximations of what is and is not going to work. And at some point in time, again, it's probably going to reach a level where we say, all right, this is good enough. We've kind of, you know, saturated this as much as we can. But what ends up happening is then you end up moving to other use cases, right? Shobhit mentioned agents. It's a very interesting direction that we're going in. Well, now you don't just have text. You don't just have that going out of the RAG. Now you have, I am calling functions. I am using tools. I'm having something else happen in the middle. My execution plan as an LLM agent is absolutely all over the place. Now you don't just have an R and a G. Now you have, I don't know how many things. Every single time you add, now how do you benchmark? Now how do you benchmark? So we all are having a lot of fun constantly making new problems for ourselves that then have to test, that then reveal additional problems and things we can implement.
Yeah. I love the idea that kind of like eval design itself is trying to hill climb, like basically like, yeah, has like a very similar pattern to the evals themselves.
So, so Tim, just working with real clients, one of my big clients, we're looking at contracts. And RAG is a great example of that, right? Given a whole bunch of a few thousand contracts, I would ask questions against it, expect to get good answers, right? So when you start to look at the kind of questions and queries that people are going, what's going to be insightful for them? There's a level one question is, can I find something in a contract that tells me what's the expiry date of the contract? Or is there an exit clause in this contract or not? That's a simple RAG pattern, right? Very naive and can work. Then you start to look at, this is a contract, but then it has amendments stapled to it. And now the answer of the end date actually is in the third amendment that overrides the previous amendment, right? So now you're looking at the whole chain of thought of how to read this particular document. Then a level three of a question could be, when I'm trying to cross compare and say, hey, I want to order another 1,000 units, which one of these contracts is closest to the threshold where I'm going to get some cash back? It's a more complex question. And you just very quickly start to move away from a RAG. So the perception is that, oh, I can dump contracts, ask questions. But in reality, a human would have gone and looked at another system in an SAP and said, here are all the orders till date, and then done some math on it, and then given you an answer that's going across. So it's not quite RAG. There's no document that gives you the answer that you can go retrieve on demand. So you need to have some sort of a router in the middle that understands what kind of question is asked. And then you may have to go chat with some structured data at the back end to bring that in and then call unstructured. It starts to get really complex. So we talk about RAG, but we should really be talking more about the use case end-to-end that has much more than just the RAG patterns need to be metrics. So that's more complex than what, Marina, you were talking about. And now we're talking about a whole end-to-end chain and how do you measure accuracy in this case? Two different people will have two different answers.
Yeah. See, we even disagree because I call all of that RAG in my mind. And so like, we don't even agree on what RAG patterns are, because to me, I'm like, great, you're retrieving a function answer. You're retrieving something from a knowledge base. You're still kind of, you know, retrieving this case just means, you know, function call. But so even with that, right, you can think of RAG pattern as just a single call and only an informational query. You can think of it as the entire thing that you're talking about, Shobhit. And I think that you end up having to extend how you do the evaluation. Great. We've done it for one small pattern. Now, how about when you extend? So yeah, you're right, Tim. Hill climbing. Why sit on our laurels when there are more complicated problems to
like
solve?
Like evals we could be building. Yeah. And I mean, you know, my bias is just like, I think one of the things I'm most interested to see in the AI space is just like the continued growth of evals as an industry. Because this is like where the endless value will emerge, right? Which is like companies being like, is it good? And it like actually ends up being like this very, very deep question that really requires some real sort of craft and expertise. So, Vagner, you get the privilege of having the last word on the episode as our debut guest this episode. Any final thoughts on kind of the benchmarking question or RAG in general? I mean, I'm always excited about RAG hot takes.
Well, not a word that relates to RAG, just a final word that I like more of a provocation. Like, so for folks interested in on responsible AI, I think it's worth to try to go beyond your discipline, identity, your bubble of content, and try to reach out to other contents. Because, and it, we are talking about FAccT, and FAccT is interesting because they go to a more technical and also more to the humanities. So try to find a subject that you're interested in, like RAG or other subjects, and try to go outside your discipline and identity. I think it's good for the whole community as a whole.
Yeah, for sure. That's a great note to end on. Well, that's all the time we have for today. Marina Shobhit, thanks for joining us again.
Thank you so much for having us, Tim. This is awesome. The most fun thing we do every week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Thanks for joining. And Vagner, thanks for joining. And hopefully we'll have you back again sometime.
Thank you.
Great. Well, if you enjoyed what you heard, you can get MOE on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and good podcast platforms everywhere. And we'll see you next week.